What's going on, guys? Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to this video where I want to talk to you about the top 10 Spring Boot interview questions with answers as well as examples. So if you're brand new to the channel, we've got a brand new platform which covers Spring and Spring Boot, Java, DevOps, and we even have a complete roadmap that you could follow. So go check it out. But in this video, I want to go over the top 10 Spring Boot interview questions because this is something that a lot of you have been asking for. So I'm going to be jumping between the slides as well as IntelliJ so that you can see how things work. But hopefully by the end of this video, you should have a clear understanding and be ready for tackling interviews about Spring Boot. All right, so let's begin with the very first question. That is, what is Spring Boot and how it differs from Spring Framework? So this one right here, if you haven't done much of Spring Framework, then you kind of need to know about Spring Framework, to be honest. And Spring Framework is mainly about dependency injection, really. And before Spring Boot even existed, we had to configure pretty much everything ourselves by using XML, and yeah, it was a nightmare. So Spring Boot is an extension of the Spring Framework that simplifies the application development by auto-configuring the application based on the dependencies that you have. So I'll show you this when it comes to auto-configuration. And I'll show you an example for this in a second. So also it provides embedded servers such as Jetty, Tomcat, and I think Undertow as well. And it eliminates the need for XML. So if you've done Spring before, it used to be a nightmare. The cool thing about Spring Boot is that it provides production ready features such as health checks and metrics with Spring Actuator. So in here I have IntelliJ, and this is pretty much a bare bone Spring application that doesn't have much, but essentially in here you can see that all I need is this annotation in here, and if I run the application, you should see that we have, you know, you've seen this time and time again, and if you haven't, we've got courses on this. But you can see here Tomcat started on port 8080, and here we have a web server which is up and running, and we can start to implement RESTful APIs. And you can see the context path is forward slash, but you can see that we haven't done anything, right? So we just added the dependency and we get all of this out of the box. So this is Spring Boot. All right, now this leads nicely into the advantages of using Spring Boot. So essentially faster development with auto configuration. So you've seen that I've only added one annotation, and then we have a web server up and running. We have JSON provided, so JSON serialization and deserialization out of the box, and the reduced boilerplate, embedded servers, as I've just said. It also provides microservices ready architecture. So the Spring Boot, it really shines when you want to use microservices. I've also mentioned about production ready with Actuator and easy dependency management with Spring Boot starter dependencies. So I'll show you this in a second. So this is pretty much it. So if I actually show you this dependency in here, so in here, if I open up Gradle, so I'm actually using Gradle this time, so build.gradle, and in here, you can see that we have dependency section in here. So have a look. So we have this dependency or Spring Framework, and then Spring Boot Starter, so Spring Boot Starter, and then web. So for writing RESTful APIs, we have web. For interacting with the database, we have multiple different dependencies. So here, if I click on Starter, for example, say that you want to work with SQL. So here, maybe Spring Data JPA. So I can select that. And in here, let me just say, okay, even though that's not going to work, but you can see that. So this follows the exact same pattern, Spring Boot Starter, and then Data JPA. So the beauty with this is that we have these dependencies that auto-configure a bunch of stuff for us without us having to do much. So let me actually undo this because we don't need this dependency in here. And let me just reload that. All right, perfect. Let's move on to the next question. All right, so this next question, I've just showed you actually, what is Spring Boot Starter? So essentially is a set of convenient dependencies, descriptors you can include in your application. So if you want to build RESTful APIs, you have Spring Boot Startup Web, which bundles Spring MVC, Jackson, and embedded Tomcat. If you want to work with databases and a bunch of other things, basically, you always have a starter for whatever you're trying to build. And it simplifies dependency management by grouping commonly used libraries for specific functionalities. Nice and easy. All right, the next question is, what is Spring Boot Auto Configuration? So you see that if you add a dependency, you get stuff out of the box, which is given for free, right? So this happens because Spring Boot uses @enable auto configuration. So this is one annotation. And it automatically configures beans based on the class path and property files. So as you saw with Spring Boot Startup Web, it's on the class path. It auto configures Spring MVC, Dispatcher Servlet, and Tomcat. So if I go back to IntelliJ and open up the sample application in here, and you can see that we have this annotation. And I'll come back to this annotation in a second. But what I can do here is I can add parentheses, and then I can say exclude in here and say that I want to exclude just like this. And in here, I can say org.springframework.boot.autoconfigure.web.servlet.webmvc. And you can see this class in here, so auto configuration. So dot and then class, basically. And this class in here is what configures web MVC. So if I click on it, you can see that it contains a lot of stuff in here. And you can see, have a look, conditional on property, spring.mvc, and then the name, basically these are properties. So if it's there, then enable. If not, then do X. So I'm not gonna go through this class in here, but this is how it works. So if I close that, and in here, I could just get rid of this, and we don't need that. All right, so let's move on to the next question, which is the purpose of the @SpringBoot annotation. So if I go back to IntelliJ again, and this annotation in here, basically, it's a wrapper on top of @enable auto configuration component scan, so @component scan, and in here, @configuration. So basically, instead of you having to define these three annotations, it's basically a wrapper around those three annotations, all right? So if I, in here, so let me just go back, and if I comment this and say, so here, let's just say @, and then configuration, and then @, and then component, scan, and then @enable auto configuration, and then let's just run this. You can see that things still work and is the exact same thing. All right, so this is the meaning of this annotation in here. So @configuration marks the class as the source of bean definitions. @componentScan, this is where to find and initialize those beans. So currently you can basically specify the packages. So here you can see base packages. You can specify a different package, but by default it uses the default package and sub packages. And then @enable configuration. So this one in here tells Spring Boot to auto configure everything based on what's on the class path. So nice and simple. All right, so let's get rid of that and then enable this. Let's go back to the next question. So we just spoke about this. So how do you create a REST API using Spring Boot? So very simple. So here, I'm not going to even show you how to do this, but you basically annotate the controller with @restController annotation in here. And then we use @requestMapping for specific mappings. So for a GET request, you basically use @getMapping. For a POST request, @postMapping, deleteMapping, @deleteMapping, so on and so forth. Then what is Spring Boot Actuator? So this one is one of the production ready features that we spoke about. It allows you to provide health checks. So /actuator/health. So this is useful if you have your application behind a load balancer. So the load balancer can keep on sending requests to this endpoint and then see whether it's healthy or not. Also metrics, so metrics about a bunch of things, so CPU usage, memory, so on and so forth, as well as thread dumps, environment variable, beans, and a bunch more. Then we have how do you handle exceptions. So I think I've done a video on this, but basically you could have you could handle exceptions throughout your code base, but the best thing to do is to use the add controller advice as well as exception handler, where you have a class where you globally handle all of these exceptions. So here's an example. So you say add controller advice. So this is the class. And then here you basically have a method that handles whatever exception that you want. And then you have full control of the status codes that goes back to the clients. All right. So this is how to do it. Then we have Spring profiles. So this basically allows you to define different configurations for different environments. So development, test, and production. And you could imagine that for your local development environment, you want to connect to a database which is running on Docker, for example. But when you deploy to AWS, you want to connect to RDS, for example. So then you could have the exact same property in here and then just switch between these different profiles. And then finally, how does Spring Boot support externalized configuration? So there's a few ways. So one is by using application properties or YAML. So depending on which one your team follows, then you can override by using command line arguments, environment variables, or the one which people tend to, you know, when they learn about microservices, they think, oh, I need to use config server, but you don't config server. All right. This is just an extra pet that you need to manage, basically a server. And as you go to production, I'm saying here, if you work for an enterprise or a large company, you know, you've got thousands and thousands of microservices, then there's better ways of doing this. But anyway, so this allows flexible configuration without modifying your code. So this is the beauty by following any of these steps. And this is pretty much it. And if you want to learn more about Spring Boot, we have a complete roadmap that teaches you everything you need to know about Spring, Spring Boot, Java, full stack development, and the whole shebang. All right, so for now, I'll see you on the next one. Assalamu alaikum.